It's a great pleasure for me to be here, to have been invited in this symposium in honor of Gian Piero Del Piero. He has influenced the research of so many people, including me, of course. And I have to say that I remember with great pleasure the meetings he used to organize in Ferrara, which were a unique opportunities for young researcher like me at that time to share their experience, to meet together and to have precious advice. And for this, he has my most grateful appreciation. The title of my talk is Towards a Unified Approach to Fracture, Yielding, and Damage. And this is indeed, on purpose, the same title of a paper by Gian Piero Del Piero in 1998. From these, many other contributions have been done. I just mentioned a few. And going from this, which was a paper which contained many ideas and that I read with the greatest interest, to the last one with Lev Truskinovsky. And my committee now is very easy because you have seen all the features of this kind of models in the lectures that have been given in this symposium. Now, with preamble, fracture, damage, and plasticity. This seems a very different in type phenomenon. Fracture mechanics is based upon an energy balance. And the key ingredient is to have some sort of surface energy to describe the phenomenon. On the other hand, the damage mechanics and plasticity are usually considered bulk phenomena that happen in the bulk part of the material, and they are usually described by smooth fields. In the case of damage mechanics, you have a damage parameter field, which usually varies between 0 and 1. In the case of plasticity, you have a macroscopic stress-strain relationship, strain decomposition, yield criterion, flow rule, hardening law. So the usual treatment of this phenomenon is very different. And in Del Piero class of model, this is the prototype, it's a very, very simple model, but with so many features. Because the idea is just to have a simple one-dimensional model of a bar in a hard device, to have a decomposition of the energy in a bulk part and the surface energy part, which takes value on the jumps of U. And treating this as a variational problem, you find some interesting implication both for what the local and global minimizer are concerned. And the major result, in my opinion, is that just varying the form of this, just varying the form of the fracture energy part, of the surface energy part, you can have different type responses. From Griffith response, in which we have some delicate issues which concern local and global minimizer that I'm sure that you have considered in the lectures, to energy a la Barenblatt, which can give you this strain softening response or a snapback response according to the length of the bar. And this is a phenomenon that cannot be constitutive. It's just the interaction, the energetic balance between different type of responses. With the model energy, also in this case, you have very different type responses, and you have a nucleation of several fractures which resemble damage model. And with a convex concave energy, you have an infimizing sequence that gives rise to a horizontal plateau that you can interpret as the onset of plastic deformation. So these different type phenomenon are included all in the same class of model. What changes is the form of the fracture energy part, of the surface energy part. What I want to do now, so far the model is one-dimensional. Now I want to study at least the two-dimensional case, because two-dimensional can give you for free some effects, some non-locality, some interaction, and the model becomes quite richer if you go to a higher dimension. And we'll assume a very simple expression for the surface energy term, and I want to demonstrate, I want to show, demonstrate is a big word, the different type of responses like fracture damage and yielding can be reproduced by the same class of model in the 2D case. And what determines the response apart from the material parameters is, of course, in this case, the shape, the size, and the possible presence of defects. The model that I consider is this one. It is in the simplest case of antiplane shear. This is the potato in which you have a Dirichlet boundary, a Neumann boundary usually assumed with zero traction. U is the out-of-plane displacement. I beg the pardon of the mathematician because the notation is not very accurate mathematically, but I prefer to be as simple as possible. Gradient U, of course, you know what it is. Mu represent the Lamé shear constant. SU is the set of jump points for U, and U plus minus U minus is the trace of the displacement field on a set of jump point SU. And this is, of course, elastic energy. This you may interpret as a surface energy a la Griffith. The new term is the one. This one represents a cohesive term, which, of course, the difference between the Griffith approach and this approach is that in Griffith approach, once you have nucleated the crack, you can have the separation of the two materials with no other energy consumption. Now, in order to obtain the separation of the material, you, after the crack has nucleated, or the slip plane has nucleated, in this case we're dealing with antiplane shear, so we prefer to think of slip planes, slip surfaces, rather than crack surfaces, you have to spend more energy in order to have the separation of the material. Of course, you have to take into account irreversibility of inelastic glide, of inelastic slip. To do so, the load history is divided into some steps, and the deformation is followed through a sequence of minimization problem. Here you have a graph. The boundary data is supposed to be reached at several steps, and you minimize at the step I minus 1 a functional of this type, which contains terms which were reminiscent of what happens at the step I minus 1. In other words, the work expended on gliding depends upon the absolute value of the incremental slip. This means that if you glide, if you produce gliding in one slip plane or slip surface, and you go back, you have to spend the work back and forth. And the 1D counterpart of this approach is a direct shear test on a soil, which is a very standard test that is done in geotechnical engineering, usually on soft materials like over-consolidated clay. This is the box, you put the soil inside and you shear that in order to drive a glide surface across one horizontal plane. If you do this kind of experiment, you find that the diagram, typical diagram of shear forces versus relative displacement is of this type. What you find is that usually in order to produce glide, you have to overcome an energetic barrier. And this energetic barrier is due to the unpinning of the glide surface. The mechanism of gliding may be different, but in plasticity, but especially in this kind of soils, you have to overcome this barrier in order to start the gliding surface. And from a mathematical point of view, I can tell you that this term, of course, this unpinning energy is modeled by this term. this term is crucial to have a convergence, to have a nice mathematical model to be put in the computer. And if you let gamma goes to zero, the material doesn't reach any resistance, because from a mathematical point of view, it turns out to be not very well posed. And this idea is not new, that in order to have plasticity, you have to produce unpinning of a glide surface. For example, there is this old paper by Palmer and Rice, which is very... I read it with great attention, in which in order to reproduce this kind of experiment, they used the concept of fracture mechanics associated with plasticity in order to follow the progression of a slip surface. If you do this model from the 1D case, the response that you have is like that. You start from here, you have this is the prototype of direct shear test. You have these two pieces, and you are just gliding across this horizontal plane. And the two parts are displaced apart, so the upper part is displaced apart from with respect to the lower part. And if you do this kind of calculation, very simple, you find out that you have a first horizontal branch, then you first linear branch, then you unpin the gliding surface, and you drop a little bit, and then you start gliding, you have a horizontal plateau, and then if you release, you can follow this kind of loop, which is typical of plasticity. And the jump here, this one, is very well known in anybody who does experiments in plasticity, because this point A is usually called the upper yield point, and point A prime, it is the lower yield point. And the jump from the upper to the lower yield point is associated, of course, to the gamma, to the unpinning, to the energy necessary for unpinning the glide surface. Comparing with experiments, you find out that the response for the model is idealized like that, and what you get from experiment is a curve like this. Now, particular cases. Of course, if you consider that tau zero is equal to zero, then you recover the model a la Griffith, which is a very well and important work by Frankfurt and Marigot. And the importance also of this kind of model is the fact that these are free discontinuity models, difficult to implement from a numerical point of view. And in this important paper, Bourdain-Frankfurt and Marigot, I'm sorry, I guess this is the wrong citation because it is the second paper. The free discontinuity problem with a shark crack approach by Bourdain, Frankfurt, and Marigot, in which you have elasticity plus surface energy, and you engage energetic competition like Griffith with no need of any a priori existing crack to develop the calculation in the model. And for example, it happens like this, and omega here represent the set where the discontinuity occurs. But even more interesting is this other approach, in my opinion, by Frankfurt and Marigot together with Bourdain in the year 2000, in which mainly for numerical purposes they tried this regularization of the model using a result by Ambrogio and Tortorelli for the Mumford-Shah functional. And in this kind of model, this is a two-field model in which the discontinuity is approximated by a region in a band where the strain becomes very large. And there is another parameter in this model, which is this quantity L, which dimensionally has the same dimension of the length. What happens in this model if you do the same experiment, if you break the heart? It's like in this region you have the concentration of deformation, but of strain, but not a neat separation, and the region where this happened becomes a bend, not a line or a surface. In order to understand this model, I've been told, I'm sorry, many of you, of course, knows this, but I've been told to give a talk also for PhD students. In order to understand what is the importance of this, some heuristic calculation. This is a parameter which is introduced just to regularize the problem, but may be of some importance if you do deal with damage. But for the moment, it is not important for this calculation. We may think that this parameter goes to zero. L represents a length scale, which is an important material parameter. And you have a competition between some energetic terms. If L goes to zero, these terms becomes particularly important. And in order to make it small, S wants to be one. On the other hand, the part which multiplies the elastic energy, elastic strain energy, is you have S squared there. So in order to reduce the energy, the elastic energy, S wants to be zero. So you engage a competition between these two terms, and these terms, which contains the gradients, penalize the transition from S is equal to zero to S equal to 1, and stabilize also the problem from a mathematical point of view. We want to evaluate this term and want to see how its relation is with the fracture energy of the bar and what is the significance of this term. And to do this, we do heuristically a very simple 1D calculation. You take this and you try to pull this bar, and you suppose that the region where S becomes zero, so the region that is going to be cracked, is exactly one line, orthogonal to the action that you are imposing. And you find out from the calculation that the form of S that gives you the best result is like this. Why it is like this from a heuristic point of view? Because once that you have weakened the material in one line, you can pull it out as much as you like. There is no need to impose S on a set which is much greater than one segment. Consequently, the best thing you can do is to go to zero in this set so that the material virtually is broken. You can pull it apart with almost no elastic energy consumption, and the set where this S must be zero must be as small as possible, because otherwise this term would grow too much. In order to do this calculation, to see that this is exactly the form of X, the optimal form, you can do this very simple calculation, which is morally what Monica and Mortal have done, and also Luigi Ambrosio have done for together with Tortorelli. And you use this very simple algebraic inequality, in which if you have two numbers, this is always true, and this is always true that equality is reached when the two numbers are equal in absolute value. And if you do this calculation, you have this term. You consider this is a square, is greater or equal than this one, and this can be integrated because you have grad of S, 1 minus S, and can be integrated. What you find out if you integrate it on a line, like the one before, you find out a gamma measure of omega. So this term has a lower bound, which is gamma, which multiplies the region where S is almost equal to zero. The optimal profile can be obtained using this other idea, and you find out that this optimal profile is obtained when these two terms are equal. This gives rise to a simple differential equation that can be solved, and what you obtain is a form which is like that. This form is of some interest because you have L at the denominator of the exponential function. This means that this width, the width here, from here to here, where you have the transition, turns out to be of the same order of L. So, diminishing L, you have that this kind of form, this squeeze becomes narrower and narrower. And these are the important things. The width of the transition zone from S is equal to 0 to 1 is of the order of L. And from these, you find out that this gamma plays the same role of fracture energy. So, comparing the two models, you have that S is like a damage field because it multiplies the elasticity tensor. You can see it here. S is equal to 1 when the material is sound, or S is equal to 0 when the material is damaged. The width of the transition zone from S is equal to 1 to S is equal to 0 when the strain localized is of the same order of L. And you have also this result that this quantity tends to gamma measure of omega. So, apart from this, you have a more accurate result from a mathematical point of view, that you can find that as L tends to 0, the regularized model by Bourdain, Frankfurt, and Marigot tends in the sense of a variational convergence, which is called gamma convergence, to the model by Frankfurt and Marigot to the free discontinuity problem. Now, what of the two is more accurate? There are materials that are usually referred to as quasi-brittle materials, which has this property, that at the tip of a crack, the crack is not atomically sharp. There is some sort of loosening of the material microstructure at the tip of a crack. And usually this zone where the material is weakened is called the process zone. People who work in geomaterials, so work in concrete, work in stones, knows very well this process zone, and this process zone has a characteristic width. It is not, the material weakens in bands, but has a characteristic width. And this width is called the characteristic material length scale. For concrete, for example, this length scale is of the order of 2-3 times the characteristic size of the aggregates. So another thing is that the Bourdain, Frankfurt, and Marigot model, although it has been derived from a completely different point of view, is quite similar in the equation to the gradient damage model by Fremond and Nejar. And the relationship between damage model and sharp crack model are mathematically motivated by this variational convergence. So one model tends to the other. From this point of view, the regularized model seems to be more accurate for quasi-brittle material. One might say that as the characteristic length scale of a material, like in the case of glass, because also glass, the brittle material par excellence has an intrinsic characteristic length scale. Also, reducing L, you have that the model approaches the classical model a la Griffith to interpret the material response. Another thing that probably you have considered in Professor Del Piero's lecture is the stability analysis, because if you consider Bourdain, Frankfurt, and Marigot model, the regularized model, you have that the strength of the material goes to plus infinity as L goes to 0. And the Frankfurt and Marigot model for the 1D case would predict the infinite strength for a bar with no defect if you do a local minimization in the sense that has been also pointed out in the work by Del Piero and Toschinoschi. To me, this is a very nice result, and should be like that, because Griffith experiments, or the famous experiments in 1921, just show that if you reduce the size of pre-existing cracks in a solid, the resistance in practice goes to plus infinity. In some construction material that I'm working with, in glass, all the resistance is governed by cracks, by the size of existing cracks. And also, in if you want to calculate a domain of resistance or whatever, you have always to rely on a model of fracture mechanics a la Griffith. So, in brittle material with no defects, it's practically infinite strength, at least according to Griffith, and the microstructure or quasi-brittle material in general is so rough that micro-defects are evenly distributed elsewhere, and the type and size and distribution of these defects is characterized by a material parameter. And this material parameter is exactly the intrinsic material length scale. So, to me, when I read the paper by Bourdain, Frankfurt, Marigot, I was rather excited by the fact that this is really a good model for quasi-brittle material. Now, the regularized model, what I've said just to summarize, the regularized model can be considered a damage model. The regularized approximation seems to be, this is not completely true, more accurate. Let us say that it accounts for more parameter, and in particular for the intrinsic material length scale. The size of microstructure, persisting microdefects, is somehow incorporated in the perimeter material parameter L. The regularized model is much easier to implement numerically, of course. But now I go to the regularized model of yielding. And I first consider the case of anti-plane shear, as I told you. U gamma, in this case, is the energy per unit area that it is necessary to unpin the glide surface. Tau zero represents the yield shear stress. And the model is like this. You minimize in a certain class of function. You have to take into account how the fact that you may have a glide surface right on the boundary, so you have some technical tricks to do. The regularized approximation. This is a result of a paper joint work with Luigi Ambrosio and Antoine Lemenin. And these gamma converges to this functional, in which the two terms are, of course, exactly the same. The third one converges to this. So you have some sort of tau zero, which is the same, 1 minus S squared, which represents, again, this part, and the gradient of U. And these two terms go together. So you have a mixed terms in the gradient of U and S. And you, of course, you minimize, taking care what are the boundary condition from S. If you have a surface like this with Dirichlet boundary, usually it is customary to assume S is equal to 1 to the Dirichlet boundary in order to model the fact that the material is glued to a clamping device. And you have this gamma convergence results of for the two functionals. Of course, if you want to account for irreversibility of a slip surface, you need to use the same approximation, the same idea of dividing the load sequence into steps and consider a sequence of minimization problem. And for the two cases of a strong formulation and regularized formulation, this is the resulting minimization problem. And you can also extend this result to the case of plastic slip and generalized plane stress or plane strain. The gamma convergent result is not available, but also Giambrosi thinks that it is a question of technique, because once you know how to do that for the anti-plane shear, then you can use some sort of slicing arguments like the one used by Focardi to extend the result, the gamma limit for the Bourdain, Frankfurt and Marigot model. The problem, because you may give me some criticism. Is this a model of plasticity, or is this the model of cohesive Dugdale crack? Because plasticity is traditionally recognized as a bulk phenomenon, whereas here plasticity treatment has strong analogies with fracture, in particular with cohesive fracture energy. So what is the difference between plasticity and cohesive crack? Or is yielding localized in glide bands or diffused? In the last part of my talk, I'll try to answer to these questions. First of all, localized yielding. If you look at the book by Nadoi, because he was Hungarian, you find beautiful pictures of phenomenon of localized plastic deformation in what are usually referred to as a coarse slip band or super bands. One typical example is a cylinder with a hole, in which if you compress this kind of cylinder, the hole drives the formation of this kind of bands. Another typical example is the yield localization due to geometric effects, like this one in the large flat bar. In geomaterials, you know that usually the failure of materials like over-consolidated clay is due to coarse slip bands with forms according to specific patterns. And this is actually the rule that geologists and geotechnical engineers do to calculate the stability of the slope stability using an energy balance between slip surfaces. But also diffused plasticity. If you stretch a bar, you have a diffusion of plasticity. But if you go more carefully inside the microstructure, you make more refined experiments, you find out that the bulk phenomenon is due to the microscopic formation of bands. These are the famous Luder bands that anybody doing experiments on a piece of metal knows. It can be found very easily. Also, the problem of flow figures in twisted bars under torsion. We know the classical solution of plasticity, but the classical solution of plasticity fails in many respects that I don't have the time to comment. But in any case, you find flow figures of twisted bars that were already known from the early 30s, in which you have some sort of micro slips and micro bends inside the cross section, instead of a uniformly plasticization from the outside to the inside of the bar. And before Prager, before Orge, before Drucker, the early experiments of plasticity, I refer in particular to the work by Nakanishi, who was one of the pioneers of plasticity, recognized characteristic feature of plasticity, that as a matter of fact, any bulk material portion is plasticized according to this kind of slip line flow lines. And what you do is usually to smear all these slip lines and do the ordinary theory of plasticity considered as a bulk phenomenon. These are pictures that are taken from the famous book by Nadoi. There is a precise chapter on this phenomenon. So you have this free discontinuity problem, the regularized approximation. You may think that this kind of phenomenon is associated with this kind of function, this kind of phenomenon is associated with a regularized approximation. And we've done some experiment on a bar in generalized plane stress, and the function to be minimized is this. This is a joint work with Francesco Friddi of the University of Parma. I can show you some result. This is a NADOI experiments on a cylinder pulled with a hole. For what concerns the numerical approximation, it is relatively easy because the functional is not convex in both S and U, but is convex at S for fixed U, and is convex in U for fixed X. So you can find some sort of alternating minimization algorithm for that. And using a mesh, quite a refined mesh, you obtain results of this kind. Now, if you use for this problem, you are pulling the cylinder, and you use a classical Bourdain, Frankfurt, and Marigot model, you have, of course, a crack that develops here. This is the evolution of the energy. The total energy is this one. And at some point, you have some sort of energy which is transferred from the bulk to the surface part, and when you have broken the specimen, the energy becomes constant. This is a numerical instability that I don't have the time to discuss, but what is important is that once you have broken the specimen, the energy goes horizontal constant because you have broken it, you don't have very much to do. Now, this is what happens for the plasticity model. You can see that you have the same figure, but you have a smoother transition. These are the three parts of the energy. This is the elastic, the surface, and the cohesive part of the energy. You see that at some point something happens. You have some part of the energy which is transferred from the elastic to the surface cohesive part, and you have that the cohesive part grows linearly, of course, and the surface part is constant. And I have a movie just to show you that the phenomenon is much smoother than the case of fracture, in which you have the abrupt... does it start? Yeah, okay, it starts. And it's like a chewing gum that you have to pull a lot in order to obtain this kind of deformation. And also, of course, gamma plays a role because gamma is the energy necessary to unpin the glide surface. And